Good morning. In Psalm 135, we read, O servants of the Lord who stand in the house of the Lord, praise the Lord, for the Lord is great, and the name of the Lord is pleasant. Well, we have gathered this day to praise the name of the Lord and bear witness to the world of the great love of God shown to us in Jesus Christ. Welcome to the First Presbyterian Church of High Point, North Carolina, and our online service for September 27th. We are so glad that you have joined us, and we hope that you will be inspired and experience the loving presence of our Lord. My name is Lee Ziemer, and I am the transitional pastor here at the church. Now, in addition to our online service, we do have an outdoor service on our front lawn each Sunday. For this week and the weeks following in October, we have moved the start time of that service to 11 a.m. because of the falling temperatures. So if you would like to join us in person, we will worship at 11 a.m. on Sundays. Now, next week is October 4th, and it's World Communion Sunday. And we are going to invite you to participate in communion with us. There will be two options for preparing the elements for next week. You can either prepare your own by getting some bread and juice from the store or your pantry, or you can come by the church on Saturday morning, October 3rd, from 11 to 12 p.m. to pick up a bag that will have a small loaf of bread and a small bottle of grape juice that you can use at that point in the service when we do the communion liturgy. Again, that is for next week for both the online service and the in-person outside worship service. Well, now let us turn to this morning's worship. May the peace of our Lord Jesus be with you.
Please join me in our call to worship. To you, O Lord, we lift our souls.
In you, O God, we put our trust.
Make us to know your ways, O Lord. Teach us your paths.
Lead us in your truth and teach us, for you are the God of our salvation. For you we wait all day long.
The mercy and the steadfast love of the Lord are from everlasting to everlasting. Let us worship God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray for your blessing on the church wherever it is gathered this day. May the faithful find salvation and the careless be awakened. May the doubting find faith and the anxious be encouraged. May the tempted find help and the sorrowful comfort. May the weary find rest and the strong be renewed. May the aging find consolation and the young be inspired. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh,
Let us pray together, confessing our sin before God. O God, we confess that we have limited the meaning of the word love to feelings which are far too fragile. We find it hard to love actively in the way that Jesus loved, completely, selflessly, sacrificially. Forgive us and empower us to reach out to everyone we meet with the active love of Jesus. This we pray in his name. Amen. Hear the good news. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you then in the name of Jesus Christ, your sin, my sin, all of our sin together is forgiven. May the God of mercy who forgives us all our sin strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen.
Well, let us pray. Oh, Lord, our God, we come to you this morning, eager to hear from you, eager to be taught by you. And so we ask that you would open our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our wills, that we would receive your word this morning as it is read and proclaimed. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I have two passages that I'm going to read this morning. The first comes from John chapter 15, verses 12 through 17. Jesus is speaking to his disciples and he says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants. For the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another." And then from the first letter of John, chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. And John writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God, and anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God loved us so, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God." The great preacher Dwight Moody told a story about a little boy who attended Sunday school in an urban church in Chicago. His parents moved to a different part of the city, far away from this church, but the little fellow still insisted on going to the church, even though it meant that he had to get up early and take a long, tiresome walk each way. A friend of his asked him why he went so far and told him that there were plenty of other churches just as good nearer his home. The little fellow said, "Well, they may be good for others, but not for me." "Well, why not?" he was asked. "Because they love a fellow at my church." Moody said that if we let the love of others replace duty in our relationships in the church and with our community, that the world would soon be evangelized. I'm sure you know the classic camp song composed at a youth meeting in the 1960s. The refrain goes like this: "And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love." Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Indeed, they will know that we are Christians by our love. Jesus said this directly in John 13, 34 to 35, when he said, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Jesus pointed out this perspective again when he said that the greatest commandment could be summed up by loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving our neighbor as ourself. Indeed, they'll know we are Christians by our love. But I've often wondered whether the opposite is true. Will they know that we are not Christians by our lack of love? I know in my own life there have been moments when I have acted in ways that gave evidence against my identity as a Christian. Around the time that my youngest daughter graduated from high school, I bought her a very nice leather-covered Bible from Christian book distributors. Unfortunately, when it arrived, something was damaged on the cover, and so I decided to return it. The return postage had been prepaid, and all I had to do was drop it off at the UPS store. Now, I had run out of packing tape at home, and I was trying to save a little time by not running by the church to get some packing tape there. I figured the people at the UPS store would have tape. And so I arrived, I waited in line, I put the package down on the counter and said, "This is a prepaid mailer, it just needs a strip of tape." Well, the person took my package, put it down in front of him, took a tape gun, swiped it once, and then looked at me and said, "We have a $2.50 taping charge." Well, I kind of lost it. In a very annoyed and perturbed voice, I said, "Don't you think you should have told me that before you taped it? I'm not going to pay $2.50 for 1 cent of tape and 10 seconds of your time." I then peeled the tape off the box, balled it up, dropped it on the counter, took my box, and left. Now, no matter how justified I may have been, it was not a particularly good witness for Jesus. And remember, I was returning a Bible to Christian book distributors. This guy certainly would not have known I was a Christian by my love or lack thereof. Now, let me ask you this. Have you ever been a witness against your identity in Jesus by your behavior, by your lack of love? Loving as Jesus loved is our call. In John 13, as well as in the passage I read from John 15, Jesus gives his followers this new command, that you love one another as I have loved you. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. Well, this morning, what I want to do is take Jesus at his word. Let's look at how Jesus loved his disciples and others with whom he had contact. And then let's consider how we can love as Jesus loved with all of those with whom we have contact in our church, outside our church, in all of our relationships, in all of our acquaintances, with our friends and those with whom we disagree. Now, as I reflected on how Jesus loved, I saw six ways that he loved. And so I'm going to take each in turn. First, Jesus loved by seeing the potential that others didn't see. Take the case of Matthew, the despised tax collector. From Luke 5, 27 to 30. After this, Jesus went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and left everything and followed him. And then Levi gave a great banquet for Jesus in his house. And there was a large crowd of tax collectors and others sitting at the table with them. The Pharisees and their scribes were complaining to his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" All the Pharisees saw was a man who was collaborating with the Romans and sinning against God. Jesus saw a man whom he could use for his ministry. Jesus loved Matthew and believed Matthew was more than what others believed about him. Or also take the case of Zacchaeus, also a despised tax collector. The crowd grumbled about Jesus' attention to Zacchaeus because he was a tax collector who had cheated so many people out of their money. And yet Jesus believed there was more to Zacchaeus. And because of Jesus' love and concern for Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus repented and returned all that he had cheated from the people. You see, Jesus saw the potential in others that other people didn't see. And Jesus says to us, "As I have loved you, so you also ought to love another." And so let me ask you this. When you see another person living in a way you don't approve or doing something that is sinful, are you more quick to condemn or are you willing to see the potential disciple of Jesus? The potential of a life turned to God. Well, if we want to love as Jesus loved, we need to cultivate the ability to see as Jesus sees. That all people are children of God and all have the potential to do great things as disciples of Jesus. Instead of responding to others with a knee-jerk criticism, to love as Jesus loved, we do that by looking for the diamond buried in the rough. And so will you strive to love as Jesus loved, and will you look for the potential in people that others might not see? The second way that Jesus loved was by forgiving others. Do you remember the story of the woman caught in adultery? The Pharisees brought her to Jesus. And according to the law, she was to be stoned. All they saw in her was a sinner who deserved punishment. But Jesus saw her as a sinner who needed forgiving. And Jesus loved her and answered, "Let anyone who is without sin be the first to cast a stone." Well, none did. And Jesus did not condemn her either. He instructed her to go on and sin no more. Jesus saw the remade woman she could become. Well, how about Peter? Peter denied knowing Jesus three times, even after promising that he would die before deserting Jesus. And Jesus had a great love for Peter. And Jesus forgave him and forgave his denial and restored him to a place of honor in the church. And Jesus even trusted Peter with the great responsibility of feeding the sheep. Well, what about the soldiers around the cross? Jesus was hanging on the cross, having been the recipient of a terrible beating and a humiliating journey to Golgotha, the place of crucifixion. And there, from the cross, he prayed to his Father in heaven, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Jesus had such great love, even for his enemies, that he offered forgiveness to all. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." Jesus indeed loved by forgiving. And Jesus says to us, "As I have loved you, so you also ought to love one another." And so let me ask, how are you with forgiving people who have wronged you, whether it is a real hurt or an imagined slight? Now, I have to admit that forgiveness is tough. It sure is easier to hold grudges and let bad feelings fester. I talked about this in a sermon a number of weeks ago. And part of the reason it's hard to forgive is that we feel like if we forgive a person for wrongdoing, then it's like saying it was okay. But forgiveness is not for things that are okay. Remember, forgiveness is for things that are not okay. If we want to love as Jesus loved, we need to become people who are quick to forgive. And so if there is somebody who has wronged you, perceived or real, strive to love as Jesus loved and reach out offering forgiveness through the power of the Holy Spirit. Will you love as Jesus loved? And will you forgive those who have wronged you? Now, a third way that I see that Jesus loved others was by healing. Early in Jesus' ministry, a leper came to him and kneeled before him, begging to be made clean, saying, "If you choose, you can make me clean." Well, Jesus was moved with pity. He reached out and touched him and said, "I do choose. Be made clean." And Jesus healed him. Another story, Jesus had been on a preaching mission. On returning to his base of operations, a leader of the local synagogue came to him, pleading that Jesus would come to his home and heal his daughter, who was gravely ill. Well, on the way to the house, a messenger arrived, stating that the girl had died and that they no longer needed to come. But Jesus insisted on going anyway. Jesus took Peter and James and John and the parents, and they went into the girl's room. And he called out to the girl, "Child, get up." And the spirit of life returned to her. Jesus loved the leper. Jesus loved this girl. Jesus loved countless others by healing them. And Jesus said, "As I have loved you, so you also ought to love one another." Now, I know that you are thinking, "Well, wait a minute. I don't have the power to heal others. I can't cause skin diseases to disappear, and I certainly can't raise the dead." And I would tend to agree with you on that. But I do believe that everyone has the power to heal. And this is what I mean. How many of you know someone who is lonely? How many of you know someone who is grieving? How many of you know someone who is sad? Well, if we are going to love as Jesus loved, then we can reach out to the hurting and to the lonely and to the grieving and to the sad, and allow God to wrap God's loving arms around the hurting through us. Through the power of the Spirit, we can heal hurting relationships with kind words, or a thoughtful act, or a fervent prayer. Don't negate the healing power that God has given us when we love as Jesus loved. And so, will you speak healing words and undertake healing actions? The fourth way that I think Jesus showed love was by showing compassion to others. There's that story of Lazarus. Word had come to Jesus that the brother of his friends, Mary and Martha, was very ill. And after delaying for a couple of days, Jesus journeyed to Bethany, and there he had found out that Lazarus had died. And when Jesus saw the sisters crying, and the Jews who came with them also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus began to weep. And so the Jews said, "See how Jesus loved him." Jesus was moved by the suffering of others, and he responded by raising Lazarus from the dead. And when he did, he also showed the power of God. Then I also think about that time when Jesus was traveling throughout the cities and villages, teaching in synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing diseases. And Scripture says that when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out his laborers into the harvest." Jesus was moved by the people who were like a sheep without a shepherd, leaderless and unprotected. And he responded by calling laborers to the harvest. And Jesus said, "As I have loved you, so you also should love one another." And what is compassion but to suffer with? It is to have one's heart break for another's pain. Whether that pain is from the loss of a loved one or from the pangs of hunger. If we are going to love as Jesus loved, we will find people who are hungry and feed them. We will find people who are thirsty and give them a drink. We will find people who are strangers and we will welcome them. We will find people who are naked and we will clothe them. We will find people who are in prison and we will visit them. The letter of 1 John puts it this way in chapter 3. "How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action." Through the power of the Spirit, we can love as Jesus loved when we are moved by the hurting around us and then step out in action to do something about it. And so will you love as Jesus loved? Will you let your heart be broken for a world in need? The fifth way that Jesus loved was through humble service. On the last night of Jesus' life, he gathered his disciples in the upper room and he began to wash their feet. And after he washed their feet, he put on his robe and he returned to the table. And he said this, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done to you." Jesus' whole life was about humble servanthood. Jesus did not count equality with God as something to be held onto, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant. And he left us this as our model. And Jesus said, "As I have loved you, so you love one another." Now, quite frankly, I can't add much to what Jesus just himself said. If our Lord and teacher has loved us by serving us, so we love others by serving them. And so will you love as Jesus loved? Will you serve the least of these? Now, serving requires humility. It requires considering another person before yourself. And this humility leads us to the sixth way that Jesus loved. That Jesus loved by sacrifice. While Jesus lived and loved and healed and taught, the greatest evidence of Jesus' love is that He willingly gave His life so that we might live. God's love was revealed among us in this way, that God sent His only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. And in this is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. It has been said that Jesus did not need to be nailed to the cross because His love for us would have held Him there. Indeed. No greater love has one than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. Jesus, who has called us friends, laid His life down for us. And Jesus said, "As I have loved you, so you also ought to love one another." You know, I think one of the sicknesses of the American culture is the self-centered, me-first attitude that permeates so many things. There are many people who look out only for themselves. And yet to love as Jesus loved means to sacrifice our own needs to help another person. And our culture might say that that's naive or stupid. And yet if we are going to love like Jesus, then we are going to have to develop the ability to sacrifice our own desires and seek another person's good before our own. Jesus said Himself that those who wish to find their lives will lose them, and those who lose their lives for His sake will find them. So will you love as Jesus loved? And will you sacrifice your own desires in order to seek another person's good? In his book, Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis wrote this: "Do not waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor, act as if you did. As soon as we do this, we find one of the great secrets. When you are behaving as if you loved someone, you will presently come to love that person. If you injure someone you dislike, you'll find yourself disliking that person more, but if you do a good turn, you will find yourself disliking that person less." So all morning after I had that run-in at the UPS store, I thought a lot about my witness or my lack thereof, and I thought, if I was the only Christian this guy ever met, what takeaway would he have about Christians? That we are easily frustrated and angered, and that we lack the love we so often speak about? So I went to the local donut shop, purchased a couple of donuts. I went back to the store, apologized for my behavior, and gave him the bag of donuts. And then I resolved to not let my temper or frustration get the better of me. Friends, we have been given the privilege and responsibility to love others as Jesus loved us. And ultimately, this is our witness as followers of Jesus. And so the only question to ask is this: will you love as Jesus loved? May God enable us to do so. Thanks be to God, and amen.
Let us pray. Loving God, we are tempted to give in to constant quarreling with you, with one another, with leaders and friends, fellow believers, and random strangers. Our world is awash in animosity and fear, anxiety and distrust. Even though we know we are to be in the world but not of it, we find it hard not to mirror the discord and anger all around us. We humbly come before you this Lord's Day and ask you to intervene, to work within us so that we have the ability to turn away from those actions and attitudes that prevent us from fulfilling your purpose through us and turn toward the one who shapes us for your service. As the world reels with upheaval, use us to bear witness to your peace. As the headlines reverberate with bad news, use us to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. As our communities wrestle with wicked problems, use us to exercise holy imagination that helps the new thing you are doing emerge. As so many grow weary and worried, use us to bring relief and hope. Merciful God, our prayer lists are long. We cannot possibly name all of the people, places, and circumstances in need of your compassion and transformation. We trust that you know our hearts and hear our pleas, even when they are left unspoken. Pour out your care on those devastated by fires and floods. Wrap in love your children who cry to you and lament for all they have lost and cannot imagine living without. Grant your unwavering strength to your prophets, speaking the truth in love to many as yet unable to hear it. Give your peace that passes understanding to those overwhelmed with anxiety and afraid of what tomorrow might bring. Confident that you know the needs and are already present and at work in every corner of creation, we humbly turn over to you those things we can no longer carry. Astonished that you enlist us to do your will on earth, we ask you to show us what we ought to take on in order to be faithful to your call. We make our prayer in gratitude for your grace, and in the name of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Yeah. Good morning. I'm here today to tell you about what this church means to me, why I love this church, and why I'd pick it again if I had the choice to do it over. After Kevin and I got married, we began to look for a church to call our church home. Since I grew up in Greensboro and went to the First Presbyterian Church in Greensboro, First Pres High Point was on our list of churches to visit. The things about this church that stood out to us among all of its contenders was the familiarity, the heartfelt sermons, and the beauty. I joined for these reasons, but the reasons that I stayed are very different. These are the things I want to describe to you today: faith and family. Over the years, I've visited and participated in many churches. Some churches were big on shame. I left those feeling mainly confused. I wondered why people would expose themselves over and over again to something so judgmental. Some churches had no clear agenda as to how the congregation would worship, but they had great entertainment. Some churches felt cold, not only in their design, but in their congregation. First Presbyterian High Point was warm and friendly. First Presbyterian High Point didn't judge. They looked at me and said, "I think we can work with that." It held out its hand and waited for me to come along. My relationship with First Presbyterian Church was distant at first. I attended the services and then I went about my life. But that changed one day when I got a call from a new minister at the church, Ken Brahman Folks. I was working in the emergency room on a Sunday when I answered the call. He introduced himself and then said, "I haven't seen you in church recently. I just wanted to see if everything is all right." That was the beginning of a new faith journey. I was so grateful that someone, not just someone, but the minister of the church, recognized that I wasn't attending church. It made me feel like I was important, like it was important for me to be in church, like I belonged. A church had never made me feel this way. Over and over again, congregation members, ministers, and staff at First Presbyterian Church High Point have made me feel a sense of belonging. After hardships and during celebrations, our family kept showing up. But it was during the hardships that the church really made the difference. It's been a place of acceptance and growth for our whole family. The church has been a constant, an anchor in the turbulent seas. It's gotten our family through some hard knocks and through loss and through illnesses. First Presbyterian kept accepting us, teaching us, and guiding us. It's been a place that's turned lemons into lemonade. I saw Tanner make good friends here who validated his faith and encouraged him to continue to grow spiritually. I've seen Meredith's personality develop into a compassionate, unselfish, and brave person. The many opportunities for both of our children to be involved in performance and fellowship have helped to shape them into confident and kind people. We are tremendously grateful for the youth programs and the music programs. As for Kevin and I, we've felt our marriage strengthen since we've been coming to this church. So my faith began to grow and grow. My faith began to guide me in my decision making. My faith began to get me through the darkness, and my faith led me to this family. The members of this congregation are one of the main reasons I continue to come to service, serve on committees, and get involved. I found compassion here and a common moral fiber, which includes helping people that need help. I've also found humor here. Do other congregations laugh as much as our congregation? Judy and Bill Smith helped us get acclimated to this church. Bo and Carol Morgan made sure we got involved. The more involved I got, the more my relationships with people developed, and the more I felt a sense of belonging. I've also found that the more I do for God through the church and outside in the community, the more I see God, the more I feel God, and the more I feel like life is good. I'll leave you with this story as an example of what I mean by that. When I was teaching confirmation class, I got very attached to the habit of spending time with God on Sunday mornings. One weekend, I was taking Meredith and some of her friends to the mountains, and I knew I would be away from the church and from the teachings that I had become so accustomed to. So I told Meredith and her friends that we were going to go to a special place in the mountains on Sunday morning and have a Bible study. When Sunday morning came, we went to eat at the Old Mill restaurant on the Parkway for some of their famous pancakes. About halfway through our meal, our waitress came up to me and said, "I have something for you in my car." I, of course, said, "What?" She said, "I have something for you in my car. Please go to my car and take them." She told me where she was parked, and we left the restaurant. In the parking lot, the girls and I found the car and looked into it. There on the seat were some little Bibles. I was in disbelief because we never mentioned church or God at breakfast. The girls each took a Bible and we went to the top of a mountain and worshiped God. This church has brought me closer to God, and for that, I'll forever be grateful. Thank you.
In God's great goodness, God provides for what we need. As a way of responding in thanksgiving to this loving provision, we bring our gifts to God. God then uses what we give to bless the world through us. Each one of us has an important part to play in how God chooses to meet the needs of the world. Thank you for your generous giving that allows us to continue doing ministry in this unusual time. You truly are a conduit of blessing for the provision of our loving God. And so, let us bring the first fruits of our labor to Almighty God in worship. And you may do this through our online giving links on the church website or by mailing your gifts to the church office. May the Lord bless these, our gifts. Amen.
Let us say together what it is we believe using words from a declaration of faith. Jesus was like us in every way except sin. Jesus was what we should be. He served his Father with complete trust and unwavering obedience. He loved all kinds of people and accepted their love. In constant dependence upon the Holy Spirit, Jesus allowed no temptation or threat to keep him from loving God with his whole being and his neighbor as himself. We recognize in Jesus what God created us to be.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life. So kind to me. The overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. The wind chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I found no worth, you paid it all. Been so, so kind to me. Lonely, overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. No, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
My friends, no matter where you go, God is sending you there. Wherever you find yourself, God has a purpose in your being there. The Christ who indwells you wants to do something through you where you are. Believe this and go in the grace, mercy, and love of the Holy Spirit. Amen.